So thank you very much, indeed. I'm a research scientist at INRIA, but most of this work has been done before while I was at Mangaki, so I will say a few words about it. So Mangaki, what is Mangaki? It's a side project that was during my PhD in 2014, 5 years ago, and it's a recommender system of anime and manga. So what is anime is what is animated, and manga is usually the paper version. And Mangaki was, so we were thinking that there exist many recommender systems for movies and so on, but not so much for manga. So here you can decide whether you know and you want to watch or things like this. So you can rate many works by saying it's favorite or like or neutral or I don't like or I didn't watch it, but I want to watch it, or I don't want to watch it. So these are basically the ratings we collect on this platform. And then, so by doing this, you're basically making your watch list and building a profile. And according to your profile, the system will recommend what you should watch next. So I will explain, I will give a few words about how it works. But basically, the idea behind this non-profit, because it's a non-profit organization, was to discover precious pearls that are tailored to your taste, instead of just showing you the blockbusters because you will click on them no matter what. So it was a bit the idea behind the project. And we managed to collect 371,000 ratings by 2,000 users on 15,000 anime and manga. And the project is open source, so it was translated into 5 languages. So basically, you can most of the code is either under AGPL v3. The platform is under AGPL v3, and the algorithms are under license MIT. So you can basically run them on your own data, and it's made in Python. And we had the pleasure to receive a prize by the Paris Open Source Summit at the time, or even the Japan Foundation. And there are no trackers, not any trackers on the website, like even not an analytics tracker. So how does the recommender system work? Basically, what we want to do is like a bit about like a word to vec, like what you see in natural language processing. We are learning parameters on both the users and the anime. So, and one way to do it is to like this algorithm, where you would learn alternatively the positions of the users in the latent in some latent space, and then the one of the items, in order to predict well your recommendation. And then once you've learned the users, you will learn the item. When you fix the users and learn the items, you would fix the items and learn the user, and so on. So what does it look like? So basically, here I'm learning. So here you would have every orange point, which is a user, and every blue point is an anime. And I'm iteratively learning where they are in space, so that people would like movies that are close to them in the input space, in the latent space. So here you would have people who like Death Note that are in some direction, and people who like Naruto, and so on. And based on this, you can generalize and provide recommendation. So this latent space is really important because it's what is behind the recommender system. And we manage here to embed these new works, 50,000 works here. And so again, like as everything is free software, you can just run this kind of visualization. A bit like scikit-learn, we provide some fit and predict on GitHub, so you can have a look. So after that, I moved to Japan for a postdoc 2 years ago, and there I had the chance to meet other projects that were related to deep learning on manga data. So the first thing I did when I arrived there was to organize. So what, basically, like it was at RIKEN, which is a public research institute, okay, which is really old, And it's a bit similar to the French National Center for Science Research, Scientific Research, the CNRS. And Recon AIP, so the branch in which I did my postdoc, is a 10-year project that is dedicated to AI. So it's like the team projects you have at INRIA. And while I was there, I organized a data challenge on the data that we collected with Mangaki. And we could have many participants from different countries. So Ronnie Wong was a winner who was in Microsoft Suzhou, and he was doing this on their spare time. Basically, usually these manga and anime projects are things that are done on your spare time. So if you're interested in the anonymized data set, please contact us. But also, so I had the chance to know that there was a data set of 3 million manga illustrations, okay, that are annotated with tags. So for example, this is a girl or a boy. So usually when you have such a big data set, the first thing you want to do is to do deep learning with it. And usually you train a pre-trained model on another data set, and then you retrain it on this data set. So this is what researchers did, Saito and Matsui, in 2015. So before the data set was available, they scraped themselves the data from the same website, and they could make a neural network that can recognize what's on the picture. So here you just give to them a new picture, and it will provide the probability that there is one girl on this picture, and solo, and she has red hair, and it's precise enough to recognize that there are some elbow gloves. But the idea behind this is, indeed, when I have a new anime for which, so there is a new movie that comes out, a new animated movie, maybe I don't have information about the ratings because it's a new one, but I still have a poster. So maybe I can, from the content of the poster, I can extract some features that are a good approximation of the genre of the movie. So this is basically what we did at Mangaki. So where you have both the ratings from which you're trying to learn the positions of the users and items, but also you have this side information that comes from the poster and from which we can recognize what's in it and provide recommendation accordingly. And you can even explain the recommendation because you can say, okay, here is a new movie with a weapon in it, so maybe you like this kind of genre or this kind of anime. But while I was in Japan, I had the chance to meet Yanhua Jin. So Yanhua was a master's degree student in Kyoto University, and he was interested in a different project, which was generating anime characters. So all these pictures were generated by an algorithm, they were not drawn. So the nice thing about it is if you have a latent space of faces from which you can interpolate, you can provide these nice morphings of faces. But he was even, something that is a hard problem in deep learning is to control this latent space. But he had worked enough on his data set so that he could provide an interface. So it was make.girls.moe. An interface where you can say, I want a face that smiles or with a ribbon or open mouth or glasses, and it will generate this image. So this is what he did, and usually in Japan you have something called the comic market, which is similar to the Japan Expo in France, and you have 200,000 attendees during 4 days. And usually, in Japanese culture, it's common to make, let's say, a fan manga of the characters you like. And you can basically sell it at this kind of comic market, and it's legal. So they like this kind of parodies of anime. So what Yanhua did is during the summer of 2017, he made the website. And he made a research article that he sold at the comic market. And he got 1 million visits on his website in 1 month. But usually when you have 1 million visits and you're doing deep learning, it's usually not really good for your server. So how could he manage to keep the website up? So he used something really clever, which was to run deep learning code on the client side. So basically when you go and make Girls Moe, you basically download the model that is a compressed model that was 12 megabytes. And then actually it's your browser that is running the forward step of the deep learning code. The training was done before, but just if you want to generate one face, it's done on your computer. So you pay for the cost of the computation. So there are many alternatives in order to do this, like deep learning JS and TensorFlow.js. But at the time, it was quite challenging to do this. And after that, Yanghua did a startup where basically you could make a crypto collectible game where you can generate these faces and maybe like claim ownership of your image. So this image, I generated it and I have a certificate about it. And so here you see that there seems to be a problem in terms of bias, but actually he also did it for faces of men, so boy faces. And it was even harder to do this because there were fewer data sets to do this. So only 8 months later, Krypco was acquired by a Japanese company called Prefund Network. And so he managed to come up with this. And after that, the problem is you want to do the same, right? But the problem is you can't, because this is proprietary code. But fortunately, more recently, there is NVIDIA that opened pre-trained models in order to generate faces. So all these faces do not exist. So they were just generated by deep learning. And you can see that you can control some two dimensions in the latent space that are some like first level style and some second level style, which is maybe the pigment of your skin. And that's why you can merge faces together and have more control on the latent space. So this is under Creative Commons with attribution and non-commercial. So you can also download this code and try to generate new faces. And there are an increasing number of projects that is like, for example, thispersondoesnotexist.com or and so on. And of course, it has also been done with anime now from this open source code. And he even made a tutorial that you can check if you want in order to see how you can do this. And so there is also Anime Expo, which is at Los Angeles, which is the equivalent of Japan Expo in France, where some people started to sell these pictures. So you generate some faces, and now if you give me $5, I will print for you this picture that you made. But now it raises an important question, which is this legal? Is this legal to sell pictures that were generated by an algorithm? So I just want to give a few thoughts about it. So indeed, here we are mixing many things. We have source code, and we have models. And the source code and models that were given by NVIDIA are for non-commercial purposes. But if you read the research article and you want to reprogram everything from scratch, like just the algorithm, you can do this, okay? So some people are even providing the weights of their trained model, and usually they are doing it under another license, which may be a BSD, where they just want to say that you can use it at your own risk, and I am not liable if trouble happens. But here, what were sold were the samples. So the samples are the images that are provided that were created by the algorithm. And there is some article that says that in order to have copyright, it should be done by a human being. So you should have someone that at least controlled something, like to say, I did some art from it. But if it's directly your machine learning algorithm, it was not by a human being, it was just trained like from random numbers, you had an image. So basically, people behind this claim this is public domain, and it may be true. So I think it's interesting how AI is shaping, like, is changing how we consider open source, as there are many things. It's not only data, you have data, source code, models, and the weights that are basically the trained models. And there is still one thing that remains, which is, can we train models, machine learning models, on copyrighted data? And of course, again, this is a whole talk in itself. And according to whether you are in France or in the United States, the answer is not the same. But usually, so this is extracted from some work in progress by the European Parliament that want to let non-profit research institutions the right to mine all the contents they want. But what may protect us if we are basically doing machine learning is the fact that we can maybe have temporary a data set on which I use to train my algorithm. And then after I train my algorithm, I will just throw the data set. And if I do this, it's a bit like if my browser was catching some page that was copyrighted. And this is how you can have some idea. So I gave a few sources, but I think it's an interesting topic on which we should think about. So I will now give a few more projects that are related to deep learning and anime and manga. So the preferred networks company I talked about not only did stuff on anime, it's also on manga sketch illustration. So here you have, let's say, an artist who has a black and white image, and they want to be able to paint it, but just by a few clicks. So you just say, I want this area to be red, and this area to be blue, and it will basically generate a suggestion for the painted image. And where Liu Ming Zhang went even further is it's an interactive, so you are basically like playing with the deep learning algorithm by saying, actually, you made some mistakes, but I want all these points to be the same color. So you just click 10 times, and then you have the algorithm that is adapting to your changes. So this is Stale to Pants, and if you're interested, you can just query him on Twitter, and he will provide you the software. So this is really how we are changing the way we use our tools to paint, and maybe it can save a lot of time for people who do anime and manga. And the next step is obviously what we would like to do, which is a mega transfer, where I would provide a face of a human, and it would generate a manga face directly, with many applications in animation. So if you want to do this, there is some open source code on GitHub by Jerry Lee, who is now at DeepMind, in order to provide this human to anime, and then anime to human. But this is kind of like it's the hardest problem in this is to be able to control the latent space, as I said before. And even some startups in Japan where you would provide just one image and some sound, and it would basically move the lips according to the sound. But here it's just the lips and the eyes that are moving. Well, I want to finish on a final example of a virtual YouTuber. So virtual YouTubers are actually YouTubers that are virtual. Okay, it makes sense. Here, what we would like to do on our system is to provide a 2D image of just a character that looks at the screen and some positions, just some numbers of position. and we would like the image to rotate accordingly. And this is done without a generative adversarial network, and unlike all the things I presented before. And so what does it work?
I hope you'll also take a moment to say thank you to the women in your life who love you in that special way moms do. Biological moms, adoptive moms, and foster
moms. So here you can see that according to the tracked pose of Barack Obama, you can move the face directly. And what is interesting is, so this was developed by a researcher at Google who did this again on his spare time. So I strongly encourage you to have a look at his blog post. And he just used a data set of, he made his own 3D data set. And he just makes sure that everything is smooth. So the training was took 6 months while being a research engineer at Google. But he just did some pixel, so it did this as a supervised learning problem. But what is amazing is at the end, you just need one 2D image and the video, and then it will basically provide create this animation. So you can be a virtual YouTuber, and which is something that is really expensive, but thanks to this kind of tools, it can be done really cheaply. So if you're interested, there are the slides on this website, research.mangaki.fr. I try to insist on the fact that it's really important to have some control in the latent space, and this is part of the research I'm doing currently at INRIA, so that people can not only receive recommendations but can play with them, like the tools we showed. And hopefully soon we will be able to generate a whole new anime. And if you're interested, we are currently looking for postdoc. Thank you very much.
So perhaps a little bit of a context. I worked at DreamWorks in 1994-96. And DreamWorks was created as a normal studio with actual human beings drawing and also doing the in-betweening. And at the same time, the anime industry was really picking up on vector drawings, right? So you have two industries racing to provide entertainment. But clearly here we're seeing the fusion of the two, where actual human faces and vector and AI will drive the innovation.
Yeah.
So this is fascinating. Thank you.
Thank you very much.